So, we want to now look in detail how light is absorbed by molecules. And we looked at the last time at hexatriene, the molecule is in reality, it looks as follows, that we have here 6 carbon atoms that contain then these hydrogen atoms. And we have an sp2 hybridization that means that we have for each carbon we have one extra orbital containing one 2pz electron, and we have 6 2pz electrons. And they are the ones in this particular molecule that absorb the light. And now we then described it by putting the orbitals, the electrons into the orbitals. Now, just for the sake of simplicity, without, there's no error, we have here orbital phi1, and here we have orbital phi6, in the middle we have orbital phij, and we just align them on a straight line that's as good as putting them on a zigzag line for the sake of discussion. And then our wave functions that describe the electrons both then psi n equals sum over j, both are the atoms, and both are the states, and we have here n equal 1 to 6, and here we have 1 to 6, and then we have c and j, phi j, and these are our electronic state. They are linear combination of the atomic orbitals. That means the electrons are spreading out over the molecules. Each of these electrons is not assigned an atom anymore, but rather they move about. Now, I told you last time that the electrons repel each other. That is being ignored. But in fact, there is a motion of the electrons where this repulsion is not dominating really the behavior of the electrons, and so one can ignore it. Sounds terrible, is terrible, but actually not so bad because the electrons might bump so much into each other that they have constantly an average repulsion, and if that repulsion doesn't change from state to state, you can ignore it. There's also a lot of repulsion, but that's what the world is. We repel each other, but no matter in which state we are, we repel each other about the same, and then you can ignore it because it's a constant energy contribution. Okay, then we found, when we solved it, that the Hamiltonian assigns each of these states an energy epsilon zero. And then we had an energy beta that describes how you can actually jump from one place to the next place through coupling. The electron, when it's here, is coupled actually to the orbital here and back. And putting this into account, we found that the states are actually Cn is equal to an overall normalization coefficient. and then sum over j equal 1 to 6. And then we had here sine j n pi over, in this case, in general, 2n plus 1, this would be then n, but in the present case, this would just be 7, times phi j. So this is how they are, and the energy that comes with it was, En was 2 beta times cosine n pi over 2n plus 1, again the general case, and in the specific case of the hexatrine, 7. And so then we draw these orbitals. So I try to be really neat here. That's why I make this my robot-like motions, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And now we draw our coefficients. We can choose them in the present case real, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And now we have here the center line of the molecule. And now we get now the orbitals because of the symmetry, symmetric orbitals. And so we draw here the zero line. And here we draw the seventh line, again the zero line. Then they all start at this point. And they go like this. And they go like this. And they go like this. And don't ask me to draw more. Maybe here I do one more. But I go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And we go like this here. They have the maximum number of nodes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 nodes. Here we have no node. Here we have one node. Here we have two nodes. And more important is that if you look at the symmetry of these guys, then we see these ones here have an even symmetry in regard to the reflection in the middle. This one has an odd symmetry. When you reflect it over, you're getting something with the wrong sign. So this is odd, even, and then odd, and then even, and then odd. The last one is odd again. And now we use the famous Aufbau principle to place the electrons all together. We have more than one electron, and we use the Pauli exclusion principle to say we can put two, one spin up and one spin down, in each of these energy levels. And then we can excite an electron through light absorption by going from the, if we have here two n orbitals, and here we have the n orbitals, and here we have n orbitals, then we're going from the from energy En to energy En plus 1, and thereby we get an energy. And now we estimated the last time, given that beta is typically minus 2.5 EV, that we estimated then that the lengths that we need in order to absorb optical energy of 1.5 to 3 EV, that's the energy of visible light, we need about 2n would be about 5 to 10. That's a little underestimate. We did very, very rough calculation, and the reality is more twice a factor, from 10 to 20. That is where it really is. So this factor 2 is the price you pay for doing everything on the board, rather than doing a real calculation, accounting for electron repulsion, and so on. So this is, but we are in the right ballpark, and you see by making the molecule longer, you can make it redder. The energy that we get from here, we estimated goes like 1 over n. And so when n becomes larger, the energy difference here becomes smaller. And so we estimated here that this one is now delta E. Then we have delta E was then proportional to constant times n over n. And so by making it longer, you can make the energy smaller. And so then you you realize that that is the trick nature uses to get itself into the realm of absorbing sunlight. And the size of the molecule that you find in living cells that interact with sunlight have their size dictated exactly according to this qualitative description. So now when we calculate actually an absorption rate, then we have a formula. I hope I get it sort of roughly right for pi squared. Don't want to lie to you, so let me see that I find the formula. This is how the formula looks like, that are derived in the notes. And we have a prefactor that contains all the physics. The V is just a volume. N over V gives us a density of photons that are being absorbed by the system. And then we have the polarization vector of the light. This is the direction in which the electrical field vector of the radiation points, and so the radiation so that vector, and then we have here the transition dipole moment that gives us the strength of the absorbance of the molecule. The delta function just tells us that the energies must match. The energy difference in the molecule must just match a photon energy. Okay, so now we want to calculate the transition dipole moment. And so we do this by using this wave function. And so if we do this, then we are getting for n, r, and now I call it actually a little bit different. This one, I rewrite it as final R initial. And so we have now a final state and an initial state. And if we have a transposition of the electron here from this level to that level, then this one would be the final and this one would be the initial. So for this particular transition, we would have now initial corresponds to wave function psi n, and final corresponds to wave function psi n plus 1 in this particular case. And so in general, let's call this one, let's replace the n by small n. And this this one here, let's replace that one by, let's replace it by, yeah, by small n. Let's replace this one by n prime. Okay, good. Maybe n prime looks too close to n, so maybe I call it m. Okay, good. So now we then can write our transition dipole moment. And it becomes then J and K, these are the atom indices, And then we have our two wave functions. One wave function is psi Cn j. The other one contributes to coefficient Cnk. And then this one has phi j. And then we have an r. And then we have an phi k. And this is the transition dipole moment that we need to calculate. Now, these phis, if you look at it, then we have here our molecule with six sides. And let's say we choose j equal 2 and k equal 5, then we have one orbital here and one orbital here. And you see that there is no point where, when we calculate this integral, which after all is integral, and the integral over the electron volume element times the position of the electron times phi j position, phi k position, we see that this factor here is zero, because this orbital is not very large in the area where this orbital is, and the other way around. So there is no overlap. And so the only appreciable overlap we get is for j equal k, then we have good overlap. Otherwise, we have not good overlap. Maybe when they're neighbors, it's a little better, but even then it's not very good. So we only take the terms where these orbitals are actually it's the same atom, and so we can now write then n r m is equal to c, for a sum. Now we only have to sum over one index, c n j, c t m j, and now we have here phi j, and then r, and then phi j. Because these are the only ones where we get a real contribution. And now obviously the only place where this one contributes will be where this one is about equal to the position of the orbital. So this one here, this one would be R4, the position of that orbital, and so this is a position Rj, and so we can rewrite this one then by sum over j alpha going from n to m times the position of the j's atom times the integral over the phi j's. But the phi j's are normalized states, and so the integral is 1. And so we just get there basically the position of the j's atom. The orbitals are normalized, so they give you roughly 1. That's what we get. And these ones here are just this coefficient here. They describe the transition. Now, when we look at nrm, then we can write as follows. We can write n r0 m plus n delta r m, where this r0 is fixed, and this one is r minus r0, the relative distance relative to the center r0. And now if these are, this one is just a constant, you can pull it out of that integral. Now we are getting an integral over the n state and the m state. But in quantum mechanics, when we have an Hamiltonian, then and the energies are different, then these orbits are orthogonal. And even if the energies are the same, you can always orthogonalize the orbitals to get a little bit more order in your description. And so we can assume, and this one here is zero. Not we can assume, zero, yes? So R0 doesn't contribute. We can choose our center for the position anywhere we want, because a fixed position relative to which we measure the electron is not contributing. And so here then we put in here just a delta, and now we have here a symmetric quantity. And if we look here, we put our center in the middle, then when we go to this side, we get positive. When we go to this side, we get negative. So this one has a symmetry that is odd. You're getting maybe here plus 1, plus 3, plus 5, minus 1, minus 3, minus 5, odd. Odd symmetry. These guys here have either even or odd symmetry. And so then this guy has also even or odd symmetry. If we have two even orbitals, they have even symmetry. If we have two odd orbitals, they have even symmetry. If we have one being odd and one being even, then they have odd symmetry. What do we need? We need here odd symmetry, because odd symmetry times odd symmetry gives us even symmetry, and only then do we get non-zero, only if alpha odd. That means we can only, if you think about it, maybe you cannot think so quickly about it, but you can probably believe me, we can only get transitions from an even to an odd orbital, or from an odd to an even orbital, but not between two even or not two odd. So this is not allowed, not allowed, not allowed. When we move by two, we have to go a spacing that is either 1 or 3 or 5, and so that is how it goes. So we have a selection. Some transitions are strong and some transitions are weak, maybe even if you have a real symmetric molecule, zero. So you know, we need to understand how nature designed these molecules. And so we learn now that the molecules look pretty symmetric. They're all made of carbon atoms, so maybe not exactly symmetric, but pretty symmetric. And then we know that some are stronger and some are weaker transitions. And nature has to design it such that very often you call it quasi-symmetry or pseudo-symmetry in biology, because biology almost never have a real complete symmetry. That's just not like in physics. The systems are always slightly non-symmetric, but still, symmetry is not a bad notion. And so the pseudo-symmetry has to be such that you are getting a strong transition. And that is how you have to design the molecules. So if I take the most famous example for this kind of molecule, then that's retinal in our own eyes. And so this is how it looks like. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this is how it looks like. And we could say, this is really not symmetric, but that's thinking like a pure mathematician. Pure mathematics is very fine. They have laws that hold, but the real life is different. But still, it's not like everything falls apart as soon as you make a little change. That's not symmetric anymore. You can basically, you're pretty well advised by saying, let's just ignore the symmetry breaking here, and what do we get? We have a strong transition, we have weak transitions. That comes from the symmetric version of this electronic system. But now then we have a little breaking of the symmetry, so then we have some states that are weaker, we can sort of predict it. Particularly, nature is doing something to really screw it up, to give all the forbidden ones also power, by putting a heteroatom. That's really changing systems. We change one of these epsilons in our Hamiltonian, and that really changes the story quite a bit. So then we can break the symmetry. They even do more. They put a proton here, and that's what we have in our eye. So in our eye, we want to really not have only see certain energies, but we want to see as many energies as possible. And so we put a nitrogen, we add a proton, and there we are. We can absorb over broad spectral range. Okay. So that is it, and this is how now you can also imagine, if you look at this molecule, what kind of radiation would it absorb in terms of polarization? And so, good, so now I maybe ask one of you. So tell me, which direction should polarization be, radiation be polarized that it is absorbed well by the molecule? What would be your guess? So I ask you, what's the direction of U relative to that molecule in order that it absorbs well? If you want to wave the white, the flag, then I add somebody else. But think with your belly.
Should not be perpendicular to the dipole moment.
No, you are thinking of the wrong, you look at the wrong place. I told you, look at the molecule. Don't hide behind formulas. That's exactly what you have to learn as a graduate student. You should have learned it as an undergraduate already. Don't hide behind formulas. Turn the formulas into life, into reality. So here's where you have to argue. What do you think? If you have a transition dipole moment, then you think in which direction it's pointing. You're counting the position of all the atoms. In which direction do you count? In this direction? In this direction? No, in this direction. I mean, sorry, but. So in this direction it has to be polarized. There's a little polarization in this direction, that will be much less. So if you come with polarization in this direction, whoom, you absorb well, you rotate the polarization this direction, very little. Very immediately intuitive. So that is how this comes in. Now the magnitude of it you don't understand, and there where nature really developed some real great tricks like doing this one, it's harder to understand why this one is really adding incredible absorption strength to the molecule. So there is no better molecule in the whole animal kingdom than this molecule absorbing light. It's so good that when you go into the dark for about half an hour, so that your vision is totally adapted. When you open your eyes right now, what you do is actually whenever you use a molecule like this with for absorption, something odd happens. Maybe I shouldn't tell it now, but okay, I tell it already now, and I don't have to tell it later. Something odd happens, the molecule is used up. You have to send it back outside of the eye, actually, sort of in the eye, but next to the eye, to refresh it. And then you use it again. And so you need half an hour to have all of them refreshed and ready for you. That sounds totally stupid, right? But probably not. Evolution had billions of years. So why is this a good idea to have them actually sent for refreshment? For refreshing, not for refreshment, for refreshing.
So you can pick up the fewer photons in the dark.
Yes, but maybe you say the other way around. What's the opposite? The opposite is when you are going to the beach. White sand, the sun shines. And now if you are going then from the beach to change clothes, you're going in a dark room, you don't even find your shirt because everything has been bleached out of the eye. But at the beach you are happy. At the beach you're working with 10% or 5% of your retina. It's like putting in a new movie, a new film, like in the old days. Now you guys have iPhones. For iPhones do that automatically, but in the old days you had to put in a new film. So that is why it's good. So you basically, you send them for refreshing, so you adapt the sensitivity of the eye. When you need it, it comes slowly back. It takes maybe a minute or two to get sort of like to see your shirt. You will find it then. But if you really want to go to maximum sensitivity, you have to wait for half an hour. And then you have in your eye almost a single photon detector. When physicists made their first today, they have extremely sensitive detector. But when I was a student, and I went to the lab, student lab, they said, don't touch this. This is a single photon detector. Is it really thing? No, not quite. It's about 1.5 photons. But don't touch it. 1.5 photons. Like an expensive single photon detector in the 1960s. So not a shabby instrument. Anyway, okay, good. So this is it. And now if we absorb thermal radiation, that means radiation that is completely random in terms of the polarization and direction, then we had derived that the absorption cross section now for total any kind of radiation averaged over was n times 1.37 times 10 to the 19 A0 over lambda times nRm squared over lambda squared. That was our formula. But we have here an energy criterion. In this case, we have actually already integrated over the energy. But if we don't have an absorption ready for this energy, we would have to have a zero there. So that is worth all a pretty good description. If you consider atoms absorbing radiation, you have then sharp lines. We have a delta function that corresponds to a very sharp line. If you have a Bunsen burner, you put sodium there, you see these yellow lines. You see a yellow color, and when you spectrally analyze it, you see that the sodium absorbed at very sharp lines, and that's the theory we have. But the molecules do not just absorb at very sharp lines, they absorb much more broadly. And so if we have this kind of formula, then we call this one here is actually epsilon n minus epsilon n minus h bar omega for absorption, and we call this guy here delta E, and we call now this spectrum here S of delta E. And what we have to do then is, in order to do this right, we have to say, where was the delta function? Replace the delta E by h bar omega. Do you get a contribution? So we read this one as follows. We say delta function tells us we have to match delta E with h bar omega. If there's a match, 1. If no match, 0. In general, when we have a more distributed property, we call this one a spectrum, where we don't have just one energy of sharp lines, but a distributed property. And then we put h bar omega there to see in how far this particular radiation has the opportunity to absorb, to be absorbed. Now the question is, how do we get this distribution? Now this distribution comes about as follows. So, thermal spectra. So this is now the simplest incarnation of how molecules actually do not just have sharp lines when they absorb, but rather they have a broad spectrum. So that's very important because, you know, obviously if you would only absorb the solar radiation at sharp lines, you would lose a lot of the radiation. That's really not good. And so the molecules that nature designed have actually a very broad spectrum, and that we need to account for. Okay, so how do we get this? Very, very simple. It's almost Mickey Mouse. But you know, I give you the key idea. The reality is, you know, elegantissimo, but I'm not going to bother you with it. I just want you to get the key idea. So the key idea you get, if you are assuming for the moment that the molecule that we now think about is not just like behaving like an atom, like sodium, but like a single atom, but rather like a molecule made of two atoms, H2. What is new about H2 relative to H? Molecule can vibrate. So we get a vibration on top of the absorption. And so now here we have the vibrational energy of the molecule. Let's see, I want to get the symbols right so that I. So I call this one F times Q squared. That's my vibrational energy. Here's the energy minimum. I just define the energy minimum at zero. And now, when I excite the molecule H2, I change the electronic state of the molecule. And as a result, the molecule is not vibrating after the electronic excitation the same anymore, but rather it is altered. Usually the molecule, if it's a diatomic molecule, becomes much longer because the excited molecules are not so strongly bounding the two atoms together as the ground state electrons do. And so we are shifting the vibrational minimum out, but for the sake of simplicity, we want to assume that the force constant is unaltered. That just for the classroom to make things as simple as possible. Plus, we have to put into the system an excitation energy that you call epsilon. So the potential energy in the excited state for the vibration looks like this, and in the ground state it looks like this. And now we want to understand how can we now absorb more than one energy. And the answer is very simple. If we, for example, just happen to have this vibrational coordinate of the molecule at the moment when light is absorbed, then the energy difference is this. This is the energy difference. We call it E of Q. That's the energy difference. And so now you see we can realize quite many energy differences. This one, and small one, even zero, and then the opposite with a negative sign. We can do quite a bit. So now let's calculate E of Q. E of Q is equal to 1/2 F Q minus Q zero squared plus epsilon minus 1/2 FQ squared. This energy minus this energy. If I calculate this one, I'm getting the 1/2 FQ squared is being canceled, The first is that, that mixed term here, which is minus F Q Q0, and then I'm getting plus epsilon plus 1/2 F Q0 squared. This energy I call E0, and it appears here. Well, I didn't draw it so well. Let me draw it like this, just that I can do the following well. So now I calculate this energy, and I claim this one is E0. Why? It's epsilon plus this energy, but this energy is, this is 0, this is Q0. This energy is just 1/2 FQ0 squared. So this energy here is this term. So I have now no E of Q, and now I can calculate the spectrum with a little trick. I invert this relationship, I calculate Q of E. You see in a second why I do that. And I write this one then, I can, you know, do this one, and I'm getting now, this one is E 0 minus E, bring this one over, this one there, divided by F Q 0. That's my Q of E. And now I draw a conclusion, namely, I know that my molecule is Boltzmann distributed initially in Q. P of Q, the Boltzmann distribution. So I know initially I have a distribution of the thermal molecule P of Q, which is equal to square root of F divided by 2 pi kBT times e to the minus FQ squared divided by 2kBT. So I hope I didn't make a mistake. That's a Boltzmann distribution for the harmonic oscillator. That tells me what's the probability that the molecule assumes the vibrational coordinate Q at the moment when light is absorbed. That's the Q, but we are not interested in Q, but we are interested in E. And so now we can calculate the probability that we absorb E, that's a spectrum. It is equal to P of Q of E. Not quite right yet, because we want the probability to be normalized, and to get the proper normalization, we need here now the Jacobian. And this is the probability that we absorb light. Here we have the normalization integral dq from minus infinity plus infinity p of q is equal 1. And here you can derive very quickly with this Jacobian that here we have integral ds, dE, s of e is 1. So this is a spectrum with a probability, total probability is 1, that we absorb at energy E. So now let's calculate it. But now we should take a picture of the board. Did you take already everything, or actually next time maybe you go, maybe as we go on. So now we can calculate the probability. So maybe questions for the moment. I see some of you guys are very tired today. Either there was a problem set, or the weather is cooler. So you should be all fresh and happy. So anyway, some questions. So this is actually a very important point in biology. Biology, you know, in Loomis, when physicists make measurements, the first thing they do is they pour liquid helium over whatever they measure to get rid of all that thermal energy. But if you do that in biology, what happens? You kill the bacterium, you kill the plant. You cannot do that. They live at a finite temperature, a pretty high temperature. So what we have to do in biology is finite temperature quantum mechanics. So this is now the classical version, because I want to make it easy on you, but that is what we need to understand in biological physics, as opposed to condensed matter physics in Lubin's laboratory. We are doing 300 Kelvin quantum physics and not 4 Kelvin quantum physics. And that is essential. And so if you have here, you go here, this is now classical picture, forgive me, not a quantum mechanical, but let's believe for a second classical is totally correct. What we would find is that the system at t equals zero goes to this point. We're getting a sharp transition. But the real spectrum is not just this energy, E zero. The real spectrum is, now I derive it, the real spectrum is, now I just put everything together, and we are getting now S of E is equal to square root of 1 over 2 1 over pi sigma squared. I tell you in a second what sigma squared times e to the minus e minus e zero squared over sigma squared. And what you find is, if you put this one in there, you find sigma squared is 2 kBT times F times Q zero squared. So very straightforward calculation, even if not obvious to you, that's what you find. So it's a Gaussian distributed spectrum with a width that is proportional to temperature. And that is, you know, by way, not very narrow at all. Now this is just 1 degree of freedom. If we have many degrees of freedom, then the formula looks as follows. And E zero, we said what it is. E zero was epsilon plus 1/2 F Q zero squared. Okay, so now if you have many degrees of freedom, then we're getting, let's say we call these degrees of freedom J equal 1, 2, and so on. Then we are getting S of E is equal to the product of all the possible spectra for all these degrees of freedom, S, let's call them J of EJ, but we want to have a situation where all these EJs that we absorb are just equal to total energy E, because we want to know how much the probability that we absorb E. And so this is this, but now we have to integrate here over all possible values, dE1, the integral dEn. And so this is a total spectrum. Now, if these are Gaussian, which in the classical limit they are, then this is again Gaussian. And so this one, we can immediately say we're getting the same thing, except our sigma squared is now sum over J 2 kBT times FJ Q0J squared. So we're just adding them up. And the E0 likewise just has the same excitation energy plus sum over J 1/2 F J Q0J squared. So very simple. So it's still Gaussian, a little broader, because now we have many degrees of freedom that can absorb and that can either give energy to the excitation or take it away. So that is a classical picture, which is not a bad picture. Many degrees of freedom in with molecules have vibrational frequency that are less than the thermal energy. So this is good. When h bar omega j, the frequency is smaller than kBT, the thermal energy. If that's not the case, then it looks a little different. Then we have to resolve the quantum nature of the vibrations. And now you see, now you can only have transitions from here, from here, from here, but also to the other states. So we're getting other transitions. And then the spectrum doesn't look like a Gaussian. This is just like the Gaussian, Clausius Gaussian, but rather they are looking now like this. And the famous spectrum actually of this molecule, the retinal molecule, is actually the Boy Scout salute. It has three vibrational lines. The lines here, difference is just the vibrational difference of the vibrations of the molecule, namely of a key vibration that vibrates these C atoms relative to each other. Okay, so it's sort of basically Gaussian, but it's not just one Gaussian, but Gaussians of a quantum structure, where you see also some quantum effects from the vibrations, namely those where h bar omega is larger than kBT. Okay, so that's what we have here, and now we know now how we excite molecules. And that, of course, plays a key role in photosynthesis, and we will return to photosynthesis through a homework problem, but that will be given next week. This week, we want to study just simply theoretically the act of excitation transfer. So now we have learned that a quantum process that happens in photosynthesis is that an excited molecule that we call the donor, that is, has a molecule that looks like this, that we call the acceptor, goes, I don't know, I cannot draw it so well, goes to molecule D plus A getting excited. So this is excited, this is ground state, now this is ground state, this is excited. It gives D, gives A the electronic excitation. And in our present picture, this looks as follows. So I make them all look sort of the same, but of course they are not exactly the same, the molecules, but easier to draw it like this. Here we have a molecule where the electrons are like this. But one electron is excited here. You have empty. And this molecule, acceptor, is in the ground state. All the electrons are here. I call this orbital phi d, and I call this orbital phi d excited, e. And this one I call phi a, and this one I call phi a excited. So no excitation there, but one excitation here. And now we go, and now what happens is that this molecule is now not excited anymore. All electrons are down, but here we are getting now the excitation. And so this we go from here to there. Now it turns out that when we are doing the description, at least at the classroom level, all we need to account for is the changed electrons. you don't need to account for the ones that do not change. So let's look what is changed. Here we have this one, phi d excited, and now here we have it back here, phi d not excited. And here we have a phi A not excited, and here this electron is in phi A excited. And all the others are not changed, and so in first approximation you can ignore all the electrons that are not participating, and you only take the electrons that are participating. And you can describe actually the transition that involves this excitation transfer now in the following way, that you say we have a mystery operator that couples phi d excited, phi a, that's the state before the transfer, to the phi d, phi a excited, that is the state after the transfer. So this is how the electrons are before the transfer, this is how they are after the transfer. And here we have our two molecules, D and A, and question is, what is the mystery operator? Here we have an excitation in D, not in A, and then it becomes an excitation A, not in D. What's the mystery operator? How do the electrons talk to each other? Okay. No suggestion. What is the operator is Hamiltonian. Hamiltonian is energy. What energy is involved in when electrons talk to each other?
Some sort of vibrational synchronization.
What?
Some sort of
vibrational synchronization. Vibration is not an energy. Vibration is a motion. What energy? Dipole is good, but what kind of energy is a dipole? A dipole is not an energy. Dipole is a dipole moment. It's not an energy. Talk more about an energy. Something energy. So you have to use a word that is followed by energy.
Kinetic.
What?
Kinetic.
Kinetic, no. Kinetic could be, but kinetic energy is. Yeah, could be, no, but not kinetic. What about the other energy?
Electromagnetic.
What?
Electromagnetic.
So it is a Coulomb energy. Hydrogen atom, kinetic energy plus Coulomb energy. If not kinetic, can only be Coulomb. It's Coulomb energy. So now I do this differently. I have now here an electron at one place. Sorry, I want to draw it sort of nicely, so like this. Here I have one point and an electron in D at this point and one there at this point. Difference between the two is RAD. Now this molecule at the center, this molecule at the center, then molecule center I call RD capital, RA capital, and now I have here this one, and now I go from here to here. This one, this internal coordinate I call RD, and the internal coordinate here I call RA. And then I have phi RDA is equal to RD plus small RD minus capital RA minus small RA. That is my difference. RA capital plus small, capital plus small. The energy difference is giving me the vector, the difference here. And so the Coulomb energy is E squared divided by, sorry, I need a little bit expansion here.
The Coulomb energy is now R E squared over R dA, and that is equal to E squared over R D plus R A minus plus R D minus R A. And so here is minus, sorry, I apologize. So that is a thing, I hope I did it here right, yeah, I did it right. That's a Coulomb energy. Now let's call this one R. That's the difference between the centers. And now let's assume that R, capital, is much larger than the internal one, so that we have the molecules actually being pretty far away from each other, so that we can do a multipole expansion. Then we can write, we can do the multipole expansion, and we call this Rd minus Ra, we call this small r. So this guy here I call small r. And then our expansion is 1 over r, or e squared over r, good. And then minus small r times capital R divided by r cubed. That is a 1 over r squared term in order of magnitude. And then we're getting plus 3 times r dot capital R squared minus R squared, capital R squared, divided by 2 R to the fifths, and further terms. That's how it looks like. And now we want to put this in, to calculate this term. So now we have now then the integral, the interaction that tells us how these two states are coupled is given by integral dRa, integral dRd, and then we have here phi, put here e squared, interaction is equal, and then e squared, and then I have, I call this rho, rho d, and I call one factor rho a, divided by r dA, where, or I can also write it like r capital minus r this, plus r small d minus ra. Or say this one is a function of rd, this one is a function of ra. And now this guy is phi d times phi d excited, and this guy is phi a times phi e excited. So that is how they look like. Okay, and now we do the expansion. Now we do the first term. So we call this term here 1, 2, and 3. And if we do term 1, we are getting 0. Because this one is just a constant, or 1 over r. And so now we integrate over rd. And the integral of rd reads rd phi d of rd phi a phi d excited of rd. And this is exactly the zero, because the two different states are orthogonal to each other. When we integrate all of them, we're getting zero. So
We are getting there. We call this one CD. Likewise, if we define the same for CA, both of them are zero. And so we are getting zero times zero. Good. So now we go to two. Now we have to be a little smart. Now you have to, if you want to know how it works, we are giving you the derivation in the notes on Tuesday, but I will also give you a very introductory article where in the appendix the derivation is given. So I put it on the web. I also give a problem Saturday on the web. Okay, so if we do, then we have to be a little smarter. We have to realize this one is RD minus RA dot R. R is just a constant, so it's not integrated over. So now we have, when we go here, then we have, if we take this part of the integral where this one comes, then we have here on one side phi d, on the other side phi d excited, and we're getting one integral of this guy, and I call this one dd. It's a dipole, transition dipole moment. So we're getting one like this from there. And then I'm getting another term, phi a. So of course here drd. Then I'm getting dra times phi a, phi d, but nothing because the rd there. Rd depends on rd, but there is no ra dependence for this particular term. And so I just multiply this one then by CA, by CA. And so what I'm getting then here is DD times CA. And from this term, I'm getting minus DA times CD. But CA and CD are zero. So 2 is zero. I don't get the contribution. And for 3, I'm getting contributions. And for 3, I'm getting the contributions that I just write you right away the result. But now I have to. So what I'm getting is. So I don't want to derive it because I'm not going to make it. So I have to. It is in this review I give you. You can find it, and we also so you find it in the review. It's the appendix of the review. A very nice review written for really sort of people who are not in this field, and so you don't need to know much. But if you do this now, then you find here you're getting dd minus dA divided by r cubed minus 3 dd times r dA scalar product r divided by r to the fifths. So that's what you get. And okay, that's what you get. And now if we put this one then into our formula, you know, we need to take an, of course, a picture of the board, right? And so if we now put it together, then we find that we have now the interaction between the two states. One state where D is excited and A is not, and the other state where D is not excited and A is excited. So both are the excitation transfer states. And if we put this together, we are getting now the interaction between them. And And if we now calculate from that interaction to perturbation theory the transfer rate, just so what we did when we use perturbation theory to calculate the absorption of radiation, then what we find is that the rate of FRET, which is called fluorescence, resonant energy transfer, is equal to 2 pi over h bar times the interaction W squared, where W is the interaction that I just calculated, times the integral of how the spectra of the absorption and the emission species overlap. So this is emission and this is absorption. So this, the acceptor absorbs energy, the donor emits energy, so they have a spectrum. And this is the emission spectrum, this is the absorption spectrum. The emission spectrum here, I don't have it anymore, would be, so we just calculated the absorption spectrum. The emission spectrum is we are here and we want to go down. So we have an absorption and the emission spectrum, they are different. And so we have the two. And so if we do that, and now W is equal to, and now we can write it in the following form. We can write it in the following form as dA times dD, the absolute values of the transition dipole moments, times k squared over r to the 6, where k is a geometric factor that gives us the directions of these dipole moments, and so times this one to the cube, so we square then, so this is how it is, and k is dd unit vector product dA unit vector minus 3 dA unit vector r unit vector times dd unit vector dot r unit vector. So this is just only depends on how the two molecules are oriented relative to each other with the vector r, but only the direction is counting here. And then we have the transition dipole moments in these molecules that are counting for it. And if we assume here chlorophylls, then we have certain strengths, have certain numbers, certain transition numbers, they come with a real number. And if we are putting those numbers in, then what we find is that that we are getting here 100 angstrom. So we are getting now for this whole thing. We are getting 100 angstrom over r in units of angstrom, the distance between the molecules to the 6th power. So when we take it and square it, we are getting to the 6th power 1 of r to the 6, times kappa squared, times now here this spectrum, call it J, the overlap spectrum. That's what we get for the, this number comes from the strength of the chlorophylls. And now if we are looking at the spectrum, how the spectra overlap, we find that J is actually very small, is 10 to the minus 3. Ah, sorry, I forgot the units. The units 1 over picosecond. And now if we are putting this one in, then you know it's smaller, then we are getting 100 angstrom over R, just a number value in angstrom, and to the sixth power times kappa squared times 1/nanosecond. So if I take the spectral overlap out for the chlorophylls, then getting, so I see that I'm getting transfer in a nanosecond, which is also the lifetime of a fluorescent, so real bad, but I can make it better by making R smaller. If I make R just 100 angstrom, then the rate is about, kappa is actually typically, if it's average, it's about 1. So kappa is not like going between 100 and small, but roughly 1. So if I make this smaller, for example, I make it 50 angstrom, then I'm getting here 64. I actually write it a little bit different, right? It's 0.64 times kappa squared times 1/10 picoseconds. And now I'm getting here something almost 1, 0.64 kappa squared. In 10 picoseconds I can transfer if I bring my chlorophylls close enough together to about 50 angstrom. And that is the whole physics of the system of chlorophyll rings that we have seen in the first lecture that I gave. That is basically the basis of it. These molecules have distances that separate the chlorophylls by about 50 angstrom. And that's fast enough to get in 10 picoseconds the excitation transferred, that they reach then the reaction center, where then the excitation is transferred into electron moved across the membrane. So we learned today two things. We learned how molecules absorb light and how the spectrum are broad because they have internal vibrations. And we learned how they transfer the excitation, and that we have to bring them, however, in case of the chlorophylls, within 50 angstrom distance, so that they are transferring fast enough, within about 10 picoseconds, their radiation. So that's pretty good, what you learned today. Okay, so I will give you another problem set, and it will be sort of a little later tonight, because I still have to see how far I got, and I have to tune it to today's class. And so I hope that is really one of the nicest examples in biological physics, where you really see how biology and physics comes together. And you know, you need to get these proteins, these chlorophylls close together. If you get them not quite 50 angstrom together, ooh, that's not so good. And actually it's not trivial for nature to put them 50 angstrom together, it's a little close, there's not much space in between the proteins then that holds the chlorophylls, and that gives a big headache. So nature had to work with this, and it couldn't get it quite better than this, and so it had to optimize it. I used really some beautiful tricks, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that next time, but it's really like we see that life is physics. Life is a lot of chemistry there, but there's also a lot of physics going on there. And this is one of the key cases. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.